Good morning and welcome, members and friends of Cornerstone Bible Church. Our time away from each other continues. And while the country moves toward opening, it looks like a few more weeks before we can be together again. Now in our seventh Sunday separated and eighth Sunday of recordings, patterns develop as we adapt, even as we watch new developments. Some of this, the consequences of this pandemic make sense, while others catch us by surprise. Who would have thought there would have been a toilet paper shortage, and now moving to a possible meat shortage? But as you have looked at your own life and then those around you during this time, what else has surprised you? And yet, if you are born again, there is more to life than these happenings. Most of us are watching this together because God has placed us in the same local body of believers to live out His intent for the people of God. We will sing together both to worship and to remind and build the themes of heaven into our hearts. We'll sit under God's Word, looking for it to direct our gaze to God, to His character and His purposes. One of those purposes is preparing us for the time we are together again as a church body. Are you preparing for that time? Seeking to be in fellowship with God so that you can love and care for those who handle this situation differently than you? Are you asking God to help you be a part of His work in the lives of these that God has placed in your life? So rest, work, play, but be people intent on fulfilling God's purposes. So now, let's once again commence with our best attempt to keep some continuity among the scattered people of God at Cornerstone Bible Church. Pastor John continues today with James 1.
Good morning and welcome. On this Mother's Day 2020, it is good to be thinking about you. I long to be able to see you in reality, not just in my mind. I am reading from James chapter 1, going to begin at verse 9. And once again from the New American Standard Translation. James chapter 1. But the brother of humble circumstances is to glory in his high position, and the rich man is to glory in his humiliation, because like flowering grass, he will pass away. For the sun rises with a scorching wind and withers the grass, and its flower falls off, and the beauty of its appearance is destroyed. So too the rich man in the midst of his pursuits will fade away. Blessed is a man who perseveres under trial. For once he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. Let no one say when he is tempted, "I am being tempted by God." For God cannot be tempted by evil, and he himself does not tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he is carried away and enticed by his own lust. Then when lust has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And when sin is accomplished, it brings forth death.
Joy through trials? Tough, but very desirable if possible. Wisdom, when needed, if true, priceless. A leveling of the playing field between the haves and the have-nots. Freeing, if you feel like a have-not, and humbling, if you feel like you have it good. But today's topic looks a little dark. Let no one say when he is tempted, "I am being tempted by God." Well, who would blame God for their temptations? Isn't God the giver of wisdom and the working of his good purposes the source of joy in trouble? Then how can God be the one responsible for leading people away from God? Well, what happens when you can't find joy in your trials, when you don't see anything worthwhile that God is working in a situation, and when you've cried to God for wisdom and freedom from all that separates from God, and no relief appears? In fact, maybe even more darkness and failure. When we're done blaming everyone and everything around us, It's easy to look to the one who supposedly is over everything in this world as creator and sovereign sustainer and say, this is beyond my pay grade, but there is no way I can be held responsible for not measuring up to your standards, and I shouldn't be punished and given an impossible life because of it. Ooh, I feel tension in the air. Well, and you should. Sin is full of tension and darkness. The answer is the gospel. But ever since reading Dave Harvey's very helpful book on marriage, When Sinners Say I Do, I can't get the quote by Thomas Watson out of my head. Until sin be bitter, Christ will not be sweet. Worship God by agreeing with him about the vileness of sin. Sin is not merely what you see as vile, nor even what those around you or in society abhor. Sin is seen in light of God. God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. He defines good and evil, and all that falls short of his glory, including us finding good on our own, apart from living for the will of God and gratefully taking all as good from his gracious hand, all this is sin. How deep does this sin go? Well, this is what we examine today as we look at the trajectory of sin. But let's start with anywhere in your mind and heart that the gospel does not reign supreme. That's how deep sin goes. Where fellowship with the living God is not ultimate and Christ is not the priceless treasure. That's how deep sin goes. This is the insipid power of sin, and those redeemed by the gospel must comprehend this so they don't resist the Spirit's work conquering indwelling sin to the glory of God. John Newton knew both the weight of his sinfulness and the power of the gospel. If all you know about him is that he was a slave trader and that he wrote Amazing Grace, you must learn more of this man of God. For now, would you sing this song to the tune of There's a Bomb in Gilead.
How long? Said that nothing is looked and I was healed. There is a balm in Gilead to make the wounded whole. There's power enough in Jesus to cure.
Whether you feel the weight of sin and feel it growing beyond your control, or whether you just think God might not be pleased with your life even though you are happy with it, the answer is the same. Repent and turn to the Lord. Why? Why move toward the place of guilt, shame, or to the good and the perfect? Well, you will deal with him. Philippians 2 and other passages remind us that every knee will bow to Jesus, either willingly now or forcefully later. Bow now and know the love of the Father. He is calling you.
Love.
Let us pray. Father, how special to be able to call you that. You are creator of all. You are father of your children. Through the precious blood of Jesus Christ, salvation is obtained. Father, as many as receive this Jesus, to we who are born again, you give the authority, the right to become your children, and we praise you and thank you. And Jesus, you shared, just before going to the cross, you shared that you were going to leave, but you were going to prepare a place for us. You would come again and receive us to yourself, that where you are, we may be for all of eternity. That's home, Father. Home. I thank you. And I praise you for the reality of what it is to know that sins have been atoned for, sins have been forgiven, salvation granted as a gift that cannot be earned. And as your children, to know to be absent from the body is to be home with you. Thank you, Father. Thank you for another Lord's Day. Thank you, Father, that though we come a day early, we're mindful that the body of Christ and others will be watching tomorrow, and we'll be worshiping again tomorrow. And to recognize the reality that here, the second Sunday in May, we have a Mother's Day. There aren't too many people who can't reflect and look back, quite often with tears, to think of home here on earth. We want to thank you, Father, for the gift of life and for mothers who were willing to carry us to term for the most part, and then to be birthed and to have life. But Father, it didn't take us long to understand about sin and our own sinful nature, and to recognize what separation is from home. But Father, thank you again for so great salvation and for the reality of being able to come and worship. You are worthy. You alone are worthy. And we would magnify your name. We would praise you and thank you for so great salvation. And to thank you for the freedom we have in this country, that still to a large extent we can come and go. And we can boldly and humbly proclaim the reality of you, dear God. We pray for our people. We pray for those around the county. We pray for those around the world. 3.8 million or so have now been infected by the disease. And Lord God, as it continues prayerfully to subside, for we long to be back together again in bodily form as a church family of worshipers. But in your time, Father. But we pray, dear God, for those who are undergoing the disease even now and other forms of surgery. We've had a number on our prayer list. Kathy Berkey is in the hospital, prayerfully coming home tomorrow night or Sunday night and being able to worship belatedly with us then. But Lord God, you know that our times are in your hands. And yes, a number of us have heard today of our brother, Ravi, and mindful that the doctors have basically sent him home. There's nothing more they can do with his aggressive cancer. Father, soon he may be in your presence. And yes, I know we could be there before him. But thank you again for the reality of coming home in your time. We thank you for those who have been able to get back to work. We pray for others. And some who have lost their jobs and there's no job to come back to. And we'll be looking for something new. Yes, we think of the economy and what's out there. But more than anything, dear God, we turn to you. For our hope is in you and our life is in you and from you. And so we thank you that we are able to pray for our governing leaders, And the governor here of Pennsylvania, as he goes from red to yellow and hopefully green. But Lord, that's in your hands. Give us wisdom as we would honor those in authority over us. Give us wisdom, most of all, to recognize that you are sovereign over everything. And if it ever comes down to we must obey you rather than man, may we be willing to suffer any consequences that might come. So we thank you and we praise you for this Lord's Day and the opportunity to worship and praise. And we ask, dear God, for your Holy Spirit to be free. Set us free. Help us to understand. And help us, Father, to be humbly obedient in all things. Again, we thank you for this Lord's Day opportunity. We worship you. We praise you. We adore you. Amen.
As we prepare for our study in the book of James, I'll be reading from the book of Hebrews, starting in the 6th chapter at verse 13 and reading through to the end of chapter 7. For when God made the promise to Abraham, since he could swear by no one greater, he swore by himself, saying, I will surely bless you, and I will surely multiply you. And so, having patiently waited, he obtained the promise. For men swear by one greater than themselves, and with them an oath given as confirmation is an end of every dispute. In the same way, God, desiring even more to show to the heirs of the promise the unchangeableness of his purpose, interposed with an oath, so that by two unchangeable things in which it is impossible for God to lie, we who have taken refuge would have strong encouragement to take hold of the hope set before us. This hope we have as an anchor of the soul, a hope both sure and steadfast, and one which enters within the veil, where Jesus has entered as a forerunner for us, having become a high priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. For this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abraham as he was returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him, to whom Abraham also apportioned a tenth part of all the spoils, was first of all, by the translation of his name, King of Righteousness, and then also King of Salem, which is King of Peace. Without father, without mother, without genealogy, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like the Son of God, he remains a priest perpetually. Now observe how great this man was to whom Abraham, the patriarch, gave a tenth of the choicest spoils. And those indeed of the sons of Levi who receive the priest's office have commandment in the law to collect a tenth from the people, that is, from their brethren, although these are descended from Abraham. But the one whose genealogy is not traced from them collected a tenth from Abraham and blessed the one who had the promises. But without any dispute, the lesser is blessed by the greater. In this case, mortal men receive tithes, but in that case, one receives them of whom it is witnessed that he lives on. And so to speak, through Abraham, even Levi, who received tithes, paid tithes, for he was still in the loins of his father when Melchizedek met him. Now, if perfection was through the Levitical priesthood, for on the basis of it the people received the law, what further need was there for another priest to arise according to the order of Melchizedek and not be designated according to the order of Aaron? For when the priesthood is changed, of necessity there takes place a change of law also. For the one concerning whom these things are spoken belongs to another tribe, from which no one has officiated at the altar. For it is evident that our Lord was descended from Judah, a tribe with reference to which Moses spoke nothing concerning priests. And this is clearer still if another priest arises according to the likeness of Melchizedek, who has become such not on the basis of a law of physical requirement, but according to the power of an indestructible life. For it is attested of him, you are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. For on the one hand, there is a setting aside of a former commandment because of its weakness and uselessness, for the law made nothing perfect. And on the other hand, there is a bringing in of a better hope, through which we draw near to God. And inasmuch as it was not without an oath, for they indeed became priests without an oath, but he with an oath through the one who said to him, the Lord has sworn and will not change his mind, you are a priest forever, so much the more also Jesus has become the guarantee of a better covenant. The former priests, on the one hand, existed in greater numbers because they were prevented by death from continuing. But Jesus, on the other hand, because he continues forever, holds his priesthood permanently. Therefore, he is able also to save forever those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. For it was fitting for us to have such a high priest, holy, innocent, undefiled, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens, who does not need daily, like those high priests, to offer up sacrifices, first for his own sins and then for the sins of the people, because this he did once for all when he offered up himself. For the law appoints men as high priests who are weak, but the word of the oath, which came after the law, appoints a son made perfect forever. Amen.
We would do well to take time to sit under this passage from Hebrews, especially as we grow to feel the weight of our sin. Why are we talking about God backing his word with an oath, swearing by himself because there is no one greater? Because there is no encouragement in turning to God for refuge for sin and judgment unless there is something beyond the law of Moses. The law was not bad and must not be eliminated, but it points beyond itself to a priest, not from Levi, from Judah, one according to the order of Melchizedek. And what does this priest do? He brings us to God. But unlike the priests under Aaron who must find atonement for their own sins and who eventually died, Jesus had no sin and continues as priest forever. And he is able also to save forever those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. Do you know what this means? For those who come to God through Christ, there is never a depth sin can go with all its resulting devastation that the work of Christ cannot reach. In one sense, this is a rough sermon for Mother's Day. In another sense, as never before, many mothers seem to find their identity in their seeming success or failure in their marriage or with their children. Other women feel hopeless to ever have their own children or feel not accepted, perhaps by their fathers or their mothers. Men have some of these issues as well, but today we focus on the women. Women, mothers, sin is painful, and its effects long-reaching. But where do you go to deal with guilt, shame, brokenness, rebellion, and emptiness? If you carry these around as the core of your identity, you're not understanding the role of this perfect high priest on your behalf. Stop looking at yourself and start looking to Christ. Know the hope of the gospel. Grow in knowing the hope of the gospel. Yield to the hope of the gospel. And whoever you are, you will have a blessed Mother's Day.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea, a great high priest. My name is graven on his hand. My
The more accurate your theology, the more you will be able to see both your sin and the mercy of God. And with joy, you will sing, "My sins, they are many, His mercy is more." What love could remember no wrongs we have done? Omniscient, all-knowing, He counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore, our sins they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy.
Kindly open your Bibles once again to the book of James as we talk about the necessity of the gospel, sin, its consequences, our inability to do anything about it on our own, and Father in heaven, who knows, who knew, and who has made the only way available. Forgiveness, guilt and the stain removed, reconciled relationship, Father, and we then being his children. So let us pray. Thank you, Father, once again for so much. Right now, specifically for your word, and for your Holy Spirit who takes that word. And Lord God, that you be able to use my tongue, but your Spirit's words going to hearts and lives. Help us to see who we are and where we're at. But more than that, we would see Jesus. We would see the remedy, the cure, the Savior. And it's in Jesus' name, his name, we pray. Amen. It is only natural, that doesn't make it right, but it's only natural to try and shift the blame. It's been that way from the beginning. You remember, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning God created a man, and from the man, a woman, and from them, we have marriage. We have family. But you recall back in the beginning. You remember Adam and Eve. Do you remember what had happened? You remember the voice of God calling out, as was common, calling out to Adam. Adam, not only where are you, but Adam, think about it a moment. What have you done? And you recall, when confronted by God, the relationship that they had formerly had, it was separated. He was a hurting. And immediately his response was, the woman, it's her fault. As a matter of fact, God, it's the woman you gave me. And Eve, well, she also knew how to play the game. It was the serpent. Not my fault. It was the serpent. The sad part is it not only began there, but some things don't change. It didn't then. It doesn't now. Far too often it doesn't with us either. No. It's easy to play the blame game. Looking for something, for someone. It's got to be someone. It has to be a reason as to why I do wrong. It can't just be me. So this morning we begin to examine the big questions. Where does sin come from? Where does evil come from? What's the background? How can I find a reason for why I am too often the way I am? You recall James, who has written this letter. He's the half-brother of Jesus. He was writing to scattered Christians from a Jewish background. Now, the rabbinic teaching from Judaism, according to the Oxford reference, teaches for back then and even still today, that within every person there is a raging civil war. Paul speaks about that to some degree, but a little bit differently, we'll see, in Romans chapter 7. But within the person is what they would call the Yetzer Hara, which is the congenital inclination to do evil. Now, there's biblical basis for that, that they would have. I turn back to Genesis chapter 6, and when I say Genesis 6, the days of Noah. You remember the days of Noah. In Genesis 6, verse 5, let me read here for you. Then the Lord saw the wickedness. God looking down upon earth, the days of Noah. The Lord saw the wickedness of man was great on the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. Not just part of the time, not just some of the thoughts, but what a diagnosis from God, the pure one. Every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And so, yes, God brought judgment upon those who would not receive salvation or deliverance within the ark that he provided. In Genesis chapter 8, we have come out of the ark, but the same diagnosis is found. I read in Genesis 8, verse 21. Genesis 8, verse 21, I read as follows. The Lord smelled the soothing aroma, and the Lord said to himself, I will never again curse the ground on account of man, for the intent of man's heart is evil from his youth. I will never again destroy every living thing as I have done from his youth. It doesn't take us long for the evil intent, the yetzer hara, congenital inclination to do evil. But from rabbinic teaching, we've got the other side of the coin, because to have a civil war, you've got two parties involved. Yetzer hara, the congenital inclination to do evil, and yetzer hatob, an inclination to do good. And so you've got the fighting. Inclination to do good, inclination to do evil, back and forth within, says rabbinic teaching. But what says God? Well, before we see what God has to say about that, I remind you that God is the creator of all. Of all? Yeah. Well, wait a minute now. If he's the creator of all, then he must have created evil. Where else would it come from? Rabbinical saying once again. In the words of God, it was said. God said, it repents me that I created the evil tendency in man. Otherwise, we wouldn't have that fight. It repents me that I, God, created the evil tendency in man? Well, then God is responsible for my sin. It is not my fault. God could have stopped it. We'll come back to that. But hold it. Rabbinic teaching. What does the Word of God tell us? Isn't that where we're supposed to go? Not to Pastor John, not to any other theologian. But ultimately, it has to come. What does the Word of God say? What has God revealed to us? What can I count on as definitely being truth? Well, among other truths, and we'll look at some of them, we are told there is no inherent good within man. There is no inclination to do good within man, within me, or within you, the Bible says. Very clearly it says, no man does good. As a matter of fact, our goodness, Isaiah the prophet writes, God speaking through him, all of our goodness, all of our righteousness is as filthy, menstruous rags in his sight. So we have a difference between rabbinic teaching and what the Word of God says. Back in verse 2, we first came across a word here in James 1, trials. We find that same word, or we found it last week in verse 12. The Greek word, if we recall, was pyrosmos. And we have a slight problem here. Strong's definition tells us that there are two different meanings, somewhat similar, but different meanings depending upon context. Back in verse 2, I read for you, when you encounter various trials, yes, consider it joy. And we looked at that. How unhuman-like to count it joy when we're going through trials, even like this pandemic we are going through now. But back there, we are told the word pyrosmos meant an experiment, an attempt, a trial, a proving, a testing, normally from the outside. The second meaning for pyrosmos is an enticement to sin, a temptation, whether arising from the desires within or due to outward circumstances, putting pressure on me, moving me towards sin. And I might add, we must be careful, because trials from the outside can often lead to temptations within and a falling for any one of us. So this morning, two simple truths, but very profound when we think about ourselves and our need for God. Notice first with me here this morning, you cannot blame God. Verse 13 has three statements we're going to examine. Three statements in verse 13. First of all, God himself cannot be tempted by evil. In Habakkuk chapter 1 and verse 13, we are told about God that your eyes are too pure to approve of evil or to look at evil. Your eyes are too pure. You don't even want to see it. God is absolutely holy and righteous. And there is nothing within the character, within the being of God himself, which sin can appeal to tempt. God cannot be tempted by evil. He wants nothing to do with it, whereas we too easily want a lot to do with it. Our problem is that sin appeals to so much within us, whether it's our pride, our ego, our self-esteem. What do people think of me? And I must act accordingly as to what people think rather than what God may want me to be like. How do I look? What do I want? That looks pretty good. Remember Adam and Eve, that fruit. It looked good and good for the taste. Boy, my mouth right now is starting to want something. Maybe not the fruit, but a nice bowl of ice cream with hot chocolate on top. And then some cream out of the can that John David brought to us the other day. And then I would like not just one, but at least two cherries on top. Doesn't take much for me to picture something and to start to the saliva to run. I do have a problem with that, we know. Yes, yes, I lust after. Now let me remind you of a side note here. Remember, Jesus is God. God the Father cannot be tempted. Jesus as God cannot be tempted, but you recall the incarnation. Jesus became man. And with a man's nature, Jesus himself, we are told in the scriptures, was tempted in every way just like us. You name the temptation, he was faced with something like it. And yet he, without sin, he never gave into it, but he was tempted. But God the Father, pure and holy and righteous, cannot be tempted by evil. Yes, God cannot be tempted. But second, God does not tempt. Look again at verse 13. God cannot be tempted by evil, and he himself does not tempt anyone. It's very strong in the original language. He himself, get it clear, God himself does not tempt anyone. The one who is holy and righteous and perfect in his own being, he will not and he cannot tempt, because if he was tempting us, that itself would be sinful. We ourselves must be careful in the way we live, lest we be stumbling blocks, lest we lead others by our example in yielding to temptation. God himself is not tempted, and he does not tempt anyone. Again, the word pyrosmos goes both ways, a testing and a tempting. God does not tempt pyrosmos that way, but yes, he does test through trials. I go back to Genesis chapter 22, and when I say Genesis 22, your mind should be going to Abraham and with his only precious, gifted son, Isaac. Genesis 22, verse 1. It came about after these things that God tested, not tempted, but tested, put him to the test, Abraham, and said to him, Abraham? And he said, here I am. He said, now, and you're familiar, take now and look at the language here in this verse. Look at the words. And put yourself, try to put yourself in Abraham's place and to think of your only child, your gifted, special child, through whom you are to have heirs. Take now your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac. Let's get it clear, Isaac, what we're talking about. Oh, it had to hurt. Go to the land of Moriah, offer him there as a burnt offering. Yes, take the knife to him and put him on top of the altar. And they arose early, verse 3, and you move down. And we're going there. He says to the young man, you stay behind, my son and I. We will worship and return to you. That's interesting. We will return to you. Not just I, but we will return to you. He took the wood and so forth. And difficult to say exactly how old Isaac was. I don't think he was a little boy. I think he was a young teen. Possibly, probably could have resisted his father. And he must have had some smarts because he realized, Dad, you've got the flint, something to start the fire with, but and we've got wood, but what about the critter? What are we going to sacrifice? What are we going to offer? And you have that beautiful statement by Abraham. God will provide, verse 8, for himself, the Lamb. And your mind has to go to the words of John the Baptist, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. God will provide the Lamb, Jesus Christ himself, eventually. But for now, he takes them. They came to the place of which God had told him, verse 9. Abraham built the altar, arranged the wood, and then bound his son and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Stretched out his hand, took the knife to slay his son, verse 10. And that's when the angel of the Lord called to him, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, here I am. Do not stretch out your hand against the lad. Do nothing to him. And here it comes. For now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. Verse 1, God tested Abraham. Verse 12, now I know you've passed the test. You have put me first. How about you? How about me? Do we put him first? Are we willing to, whatever you say, Lord. Here's my wife. Here's my son. Here's my life. Here are my dreams. I put them on the altar. May your will be done. He passed the test. No, God did not tempt him. God, as he tests us, wants us to pass and provides a way of escape that we do not yield to the temptation. We may look at that later. But he wants us to pass the test. God cannot be tempted. God does not tempt anyone. And thirdly, in consequence, thus one is not to accuse God. Notice the text, verse 13 of James chapter 1. God cannot be tempted by evil. He himself does not tempt anyone. But the sentence begins with, let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. Tempted by God. Or this temptation comes from God. God is responsible for my temptation. It's not my fault when I give in. It's God. There are two small prepositions in the language, Greek. Hupo, H-U-P-O, as best as I can put it, which tempted by God. That refers to a direct assault. It's almost as if God is right there in front of you. Diana, come on. Diana, let's do this. And she shakes her head no at me right now. Yeah. No one can say God is directly in front of anyone tempting them. Most wouldn't go that far. The preposition here is not hupo, a direct assault. The word here is apo, A-P-O, and it's sort of indirectly. It's not God directly tempting me, but indirectly, God, I hate to say this, but it's your fault. We blame providence, and God is responsible for providence. My circumstances, people he allows to come into my life or that I meet. God is ultimately the cause when you look behind that. Because God could have changed things. He could have stopped it, including this virus now. Yes, indirectly, it's his fault. Or God, you made me this way. Hey, I can't help it. I've got a temper, but you made me with a temper. Why didn't you make me nice and docile? My heritage. No, it runs in the family. Or laziness, or whatever it might be. God, it's your fault. But the text does not allow that. It is a command as you begin verse 13. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. Directly or indirectly, however, no, it is not God's fault. Do not blame him. Do not go there. That is what we have. First, you cannot blame God. So where do we go? We need to realize the problem lies within. If not God, then... Wait a second. Some of you remember Flip Wilson. In 1970 to 1974, he hosted his own TV show. In 1972, Time magazine featured Flip Wilson's image on its cover, named him TV's first black superstar. He was a comedian, and he became famous or infamous for the line, "The devil made me do it." Easy to find a devil behind every bush, or a demon, if not the devil himself. I mean, we're not that important that Satan would bother with me, but his demons, Screwtape Letters, I've appreciated C.S. Lewis's writing of the Screwtape Letters and seeing subtle ways that my mind starts to move. Yeah, that makes sense. But no, the devil or his demons cannot make you or me do anything. He can tempt us, and he does that. Temptations also come from culture around us. My TV set, yours, the music, the people around you? Well, we'll come back to that. Yes, he fights against us, Satan does, but he cannot make me do anything. We can blame him, but wrongfully so. Well, what about people then? Many examples within the scriptures about people. I turn back to Exodus chapter 32. In Exodus 32, we have God leading his people through Moses and Aaron, coming out of Egypt. We're on our way to the promised land. And as we're on our way, we've got a problem because Moses has left us. Moses has gone up on the mount to meet with God. And while he's gone, the people, well, they are the people like you and like me. I begin reading Exodus 32. I pick up at verse 22. Aaron said, why is Aaron saying something? Because Moses comes down and he sees what has happened. You remember, while Moses was gone, the people said, here we are in the wilderness. We can't see this God. We want a God we can see. All the peoples around us, yeah, the ones that you're going to be defeating and have seen God deliver you already from the Egyptians and others. And their gods are no gods, but you want a God like them. How foolish we can be far too often. Well, what did this people do to you, verse 21, that you have brought such great sin upon them? Aaron said, do not let me the anger of my Lord burn. You know the people yourself. You know what people are like. They are prone to evil. So are you, Aaron. But they are prone to evil. For they said to me, make a God for us who will go before us. For this Moses, the man who brought us up from the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him. He's up on the mountain somewhere. I said to them, whoever has any gold, let them tear it off. So they gave it to me, and I threw that gold into the fire. And would you believe it? Out came this golden calf. Yeah, right. Moses is supposed to believe that? It's the people. It's the people. No, don't go there. You can turn to 1 Samuel 15 and another familiar story of the people. And what you have in 1 Samuel 15 is a king. They weren't supposed to have a king, but they wanted a king, and God granted their request. Just because you get your answer to prayer may not mean that it's good for you. That can be scary. Check your motives, check mine. But in any case, they got their king, they got Saul. And what you have down here is orders. Orders. Samuel gave him orders. Samuel, who had anointed him as king. Verse 10 of 1 Samuel 15, the word of the Lord came to Samuel, saying, I regret that I have made Saul king, for he has turned back from following me, has not carried out my commands. And Samuel then, God's regretful, and Samuel was distressed and cried out all night to the Lord. Samuel rose early in the morning to meet Saul. It was told Samuel, Saul came to Carmel, and behold, he set up a monument for himself and turned and proceeded on down to Gilgal. Samuel came to Saul, and Saul said to him, Blessed are you of the Lord. Oh, it sounds so religious, so sweet. Blessed are you of the Lord. I have carried out the commit. Really? Man, we can be blind to what we think we're doing, or the motives definitely behind what we're doing. I have carried out the command of the Lord. But Samuel said, What then is this bleating of the sheep I'm hearing in my ears? And the lowing of the oxen which I hear. Saul said, They have brought them from the Amalekites, for the people, there it is. The people spared the best of the sheep. You were to destroy them. The people spared the best of the sheep and oxen. Who's king, Saul? To sacrifice to the Lord your God. To obey is better than sacrifice. Do you remember that? We need to remember that. And Samuel said to Saul, Wait and let me tell you what the Lord said to me last night. And he said to him, Speak. Yeah, discipline is coming. Saul, you've lost your kingdom. God is upset. No, it's not the devil. He can't make you do anything. And people, oh, we can blame them. Why did you hit your sister? She hit me first. Really? So it's her fault? I'm afraid not. I'm afraid not. So easy to blame others. Why did you misbehave in school? Why didn't you pay attention to the teacher? The teacher's a poor teacher. The teacher's boring. Teacher doesn't like me. It's her fault. It's always someone. It's always something. Proverbs, the book of wisdom, chapter 16, verse 2. All the ways of a man are clean. You remember this from Wednesday night. I believe Wednesday at prayer meeting, we heard this verse. All the ways of a man are clean in his own sight. But the Lord weighs the motives. The Lord knows. No, if not God, then the devil, people. No, I'm afraid to remind you that the truth is not easy. One of the most difficult things for us to admit. Me? I'm just as guilty. One of the most difficult things to admit that the fault lies within me. Can you say, I am a sinner? Can you say, I am depraved? Depraved? No good thing lies within me. Romans chapter 7, verse 18. We're going to look at a couple of verses there in a moment. But in Romans chapter 7, at verse 18, I read, I know I, and I circle that in my Bible, I know that nothing good dwells, and I circle the next word, in me, that is in my flesh, nothing good within me. Notice our text again. I go back to James chapter 1, and I look here at verse 14. But each one is tempted when he's carried away and enticed by, here it's hupo, it's direct, not just secondary, but direct cause, by his own lust. Carried away by his own lust. Each one of us is tempted. Everyone is answerable to God for one's own actions. We are free to make choices, and too often we give in to temptations and choose sin. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Notice what John writes. Two familiar verses need to be seen carefully. 1 John chapter 1, I look at verse 8. If we say, or since we say, that we have no sin. That's original sin. That's the nature that we have. That dwells within us. The inclination to do evil is within us. The inclination to do good is not natural in our sinful nature. Born with that sinful nature, we don't want to do good. But we can be civil, and we can be taught some manners, although that's becoming a losing art. To be kind to people doesn't come easily. But if we say that we have no sin, we are deceiving ourselves and the truth is not in us. 1 John 1:8. And then two verses down, if we say that we have not sinned, that's not just the nature within us, but that's active sinning. That I myself willingly, knowingly, and sometimes unknowingly, but I commit sins, we make him a liar. And his word is not in us. Yes, we are. Not easy to say. Filled with sin and depravity within. Yes. Now as we move in closer for diagnosis, the truth reveals itself uniquely because it's our own lusts. No two of us are exactly alike. We not only don't look alike or necessarily act alike, except that we're all acting in sinful ways. But created special in the image of God, we're one of a kind individuals, made preciously, every one of us, by God, and created for a relationship with him that our sin separates us from. The word lust here, passions, appetites, it's like a sponge wanting to soak up in order to be filled. Jesus said, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Jesus says, things which come out of a man, these are those that defile the man. It's from the inside. It's something that lies deep within. It's at the core of our very being. The sinful nature and the sins that flow out of me, the evil that comes from me, and the temptations from me to act in a way which brings shame or should bring shame to me. And it definitely hurts my God. The problem lies deep within. Trials, from the most part, come from without, but our response is dependent on what is inside of us. I don't know if you've heard of Earl Wilson. I mentioned Flip Wilson before. I don't believe they're relatives at all. But Earl Wilson, if it's the same news columnist I was looking up on the internet, but also that I was reading about, Earl Wilson as a news columnist made some interesting statements. Listen to this one. An exhaustive study of police records show that no woman has ever shot her husband while he was doing dishes. Just for your information, man, you want to be safe? Do the dishes. He also said this. Somebody figured it out. We have 35 million laws trying to enforce 10 commandments. 35 million, I don't know how many counted. Some interesting statements. But the one I wanted to share with you this morning was, did you ever notice the whisper of temptation can be heard farther away than the loudest call to duty? The whisper of temptation. That little voice on the inside that says, go ahead. No one will ever see you. No one will ever know. Go ahead. Do it. You're going to enjoy it. And I said, no one will ever know. The whisper of temptation can be heard farther than the loudest call to duty. Earl Wilson. I don't know that he was a believer. He was a news columnist, though. And these are some of the things that he found out. The truth reveals itself uniquely to each one of us. For there are different methods that are utilized in bringing us to fall, to draw us away. John MacArthur makes the comment, it's not merely a spontaneous act, my sin, but the result of a process. There's been a moving within. Enticed. Most of you are aware that enticed is a word that is a hunting and fishing word originally in the original language. Hunting and fishing. It's the deception that's used with a special bait. And I am guilty as a fisherman of trying to deceive those fish. I don't do so well. But there are times I can get them to think they're ready for a good meal. But it's a rubber worm. Sometimes I'll use a real worm, but they cost money. And so I will try. And it's more fishing to come at them, deceiving them. But there's that hook on the inside. And they look at it. And I wish I was underwater, first of all, to see if there are any fish there before I waste my time throwing the hook in. But underwater and to see them as they're looking or moving and dabbling with it a little bit. And then when they take hold of it, that hook comes and they are caught. They are caught. Especially if there's a barb on the end that sits in there. I've had one in my head. I know what it's like when I couldn't get it out of my head, a fish hook with a barb on it. But that's what happens with temptations and sin. He was an old man, an old teacher, a professor. He was walking in the woods with a young student of his, and he wanted to teach him something. And so he pointed out to him four different plants nearby. The first was just beginning to peep above the ground. The second had rooted itself pretty well into the earth. The third was a small shrub, and the fourth was a large tree, four plants. And so he told his student, the first one that's just starting to pop through the ground, well, why don't you just pull that out for me? And the little boy went over it. No problem, he pulled it right out. And the other one had begun to grow, a little plant. And again, it wasn't that hard, but he was able to get it out. When he came to the small shrub, he took all of his strength and effort there to grab a hold of it and just yank it out. It took a lot. And the tree, the boy put his arms around a tree. He couldn't even shake the leaves up top. Couldn't even shake the leaves. And he went on to teach him. That's the way it is with temptation, with habits, sinful habits that get a hold of us. They start out easily enough, but then they begin to grow until they've got us. And there's nothing we can do naturally to get rid of them ourselves. Different methods that are used, enticed. The Bible speaks naturally, honestly, of the pleasures of sin. It appeals to our flesh, the pleasures of sin for a season. I'm not just talking sex. I'm not just talking pornography. Once again, I heard on Marvin Olasky on the radio this morning about pornography. And I read in a couple of magazines articles about pornography. And I heard an interview with Donna Rice, now Hughes. You older ones can remember her and the scandal when Democratic presidential candidate Mr. Hart was seen with her coming out of his bedroom at night. And he'd been having troubles in his own marriage. And that was the end of his run way back in those days. No, it's enticed, becomes stronger and stronger and stronger. And you notice what the text says here. Each one is tempted when he is carried away and enticed. Carried away implies forcibly compelled. It's got me. So much so, I'm back in Romans 7 again. We looked at verse 18. I know that nothing good dwells in me that is in my flesh. Then he continues, for the willing is present in me, but the doing of the good is not present in me. And here's that famous verse 19. The good that I want, I do not do, but I practice the very evil that I do not want. It's got me. takes control. There's that power that I cannot break. I've had. And finally, Paul cries in verse 24, and I believe this was not, there are some scholars who believe this was Paul before he got saved. I don't understand it that way. We've moved through chapter 6 of sanctification. We're going to come to glorification in chapter 8. I believe he's talking about his present experience even then as the apostle Paul. But he cries out, "Wretched man that I am," because he saw his condition. And I share with you again what I see in myself. The closer I get to the light, the more dirt I see. We've talked about that before. The closer you get to Jesus Christ, the more garbage you see within. No, it may not be the big, bad sins. Sin is sin. It's so nice to be able to compare ourselves. Nice is definitely in quotes. To compare ourselves with other people. At least I'm not like them. No, wretched man that I am, who will set me free from the body of this death? And it seems like a lost cause. But then there's verse 25, isn't there? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. There are different methods used, and there are damning consequences that come about. We go back to James 1, verse 15, and we'll come back to Paul here in Romans 7. But in verse 15, you notice the biological language that is used here, that when lust has conceived, like someone becoming pregnant, when the lust has begun within, eventually it shows. You don't realize it for a while. There are tests that are done, but there's no outward display of a pregnancy within. But eventually it shows. And when lust is conceived, it gives birth to sin. We lie to cover up. But no. It gives birth to more and more sins. And then what? When sin is accomplished, when it's mature, it brings forth death. Death, full grown, spills out, takes over. Death. Death first, remember Adam and Eve, Satan, you're not going to die. Yes, they did die. Death is separation, separated from the fellowship Adam and Eve had with God back in the garden. In 5:25, Paul writes to young Pastor Timothy, deeds that are good are quite evident. They show themselves. And those which are otherwise, deeds which are sinful, deeds which are not good, cannot be concealed. It shows, like the pregnancy. It brings forth, only here it brings forth death, separation. I don't know if you ever heard of Sally, the pet Sally. There was a young boy, I guess he was about 7 years old when he got Sally as a pet. Sally Romero was the family name. She was only a foot long when he was seven. They brought Sally home, and Sally had a good appetite, and Sally grew. Sally finally grew to a length of 11 feet in 8 years. And weighed 80 pounds. And then one day, Derek, the owner of Sally, was found strangled to death by this Burmese python. 11 feet long, 80 pounds. Just a nice pet. He grew up with her. The police said when the snake was seen and what it had done, I quote, "It was quite aggressive. It was hissing and reacting." When they arrived to investigate and found Derek dead. Just like that snake, sin will do the same thing to you and can take someone and turn the whole life around. But thanks be to God. That's the salvation message. Who can deliver me? Who can rescue me from the sallies of my sinful temptations that have gotten a hold of me like that tree that I can't shake by myself? Yes. What can wash away my sin? The blood of Jesus Christ. What can make that real for me? It's calling upon Him when I recognize who I am and in need of a Savior. A number of years ago, down south, the governor of one of the southern states was visiting the state penitentiary. As he was going in through that penitentiary, he spoke to a number of the convicts there. Why are you here? Well, really, I shouldn't be here. You see, when I grew up, I didn't get a very good education. And because of that, I got into trouble. Why are you here? Well, it really wasn't my fault. It was the friends, my friends, and I just followed them. Why were you here? After hearing all of the excuses from many, he came to a young man named John. Why are you here, John? Why are you in prison? Because I did wrong. I broke the law. I was guilty. And I realize now what I had done. And one day I hope to be forgiven. One day. Well, the governor of the state went back to his office and he wrote out a pardon for John. And he put a personal note on the bottom. He said, I'm releasing John because I don't want him to be around those others in the prison where he may influence for evil all of those innocent men who are there. When I understand that I'm not innocent, when I understand that I have broken God's laws, and that as a sinner I am damned unless something is brought into play in my life, and I called upon Jesus Christ for salvation, what do I have to do? Recognize the battle. Recognize the responsibility lies within me. No excuses. No excuses. The enemy is within. I can't blame God. I can't blame others. I can't blame society. I have to blame me. I am a sinner. Realize that God has made provision. Forgiveness when I fail. I read 1 John 1, 8 and verse 10. If we say we have no sin, if we say we have not sin, and in between. But if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Yes, God has made provision. Recognize the battle, realize that God has made provision, and then realign myself for salvation and afterwards as the process continues and as I grow. I take you back one more time to James chapter 1, verse 12, because it's pivotal. Let no one say when he is tempted by God, no, but tempted by the enemy within. And that brings forth death. But verse 12, in between the trials and temptation, blessed is a man who perseveres. Remember, he who continues to the end, he who perseveres to the end, he will be saved. Blessed is a man who perseveres under trial. For once he has been approved, he has passed the test. When he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life, or life itself, which the Lord has promised to all those who love him. Yes, I love my Jesus, who died for me, who saved me. You love him too. Yes, the choice is yours, the choice is mine. And then the responsibility as we go forward for him. Let us pray. Father, I praise you and I thank you. How wonderful you are. How very special. And thank you for being so blunt, lovingly blunt with us, Father, as you let us know where the problem lies. It's the old Pogo cartoon. We have met the enemy and the enemy is us. It's me and a sinful heart that needs to be washed, cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ. The only agent. I don't want to say forget the hand soap and the rest of it now at this time, the sanitizers and the cleansers. That's good for germs and on the outside. But only the blood of Jesus Christ, not your good works, but the blood of Jesus Christ can cleanse, and it does. And then I too can sing, I'm coming home in your time. Lord, any here who hear this message, may we understand where the problem lies, but also by your grace, where salvation and victory is found. May they call upon you, Jesus, for salvation today, I pray. In your name, amen.
And what does a humble heart do in response to this message? It shudders at the trajectory of sin and then runs to God to learn more of the priceless work of Christ to save completely those who come to God through him. Take the world, but give me Jesus.
Take the world, but give me Jesus. All its joys are but a day, but his love abided there.
Father, by the work of your Spirit, would you write your word on our heart to meditate on these things, on both the problem, the weight, and the solution. Would you change our values? Would you open our eyes to the depths of our being so that more and more there's little that entices from your greatness. Thank you for all you've given us in Christ. Amen.